Good evening and welcome to this edition of The Checkpoint. My name is Nicholas Wasaja and thank you for keeping it urban. Today we are going to be talking to the former leader of the opposition, the Honorable Winnie Kiiza, who is also Member of Parliament, Kasese District. The Honorable recently declared that she will not be seeking elective position and she will not be seeking re-election for the position of Woman MP for Kasese District. Honorable, welcome to this show.
Thank you, Nicholas.
Honorable, your viewer out there is wondering what could have informed this kind of decision.
I think my decision was informed by principle, as a matter of fact. I wanted to practice what I preach. I've been preaching against overstaying power. And I just wanted people to know that when I say it, I believe it and I think it can work. So I said, let me be the first person to show people that when you say something, you should know that you are equally holding yourself accountable to the society that you are talking to. So I was principally motivated by that firm belief that it's not good for people to overstay in power.
But you have colleagues that have served probably more years than you, more than 15, some 20. Time and again, some of them say, this is my last term, but when the other term comes, they seek another term. Should we say you're completely done with elective politics or you're simply taking a sabbatical? Or we should expect a U-turn because...
Of course, with a U-turn, no. But I've been clear that I am taking a sabbatical and it does no harm for you to see others come up. If they play the game better, you say continue and you support them equally. If you think there is need for you to come back, you can easily come back. So for now, I'm not saying I am quitting politics like other people said, Winnie quits politics. No, I am not quitting politics. I'm only not seeking re-election as Woman MP for Kasese District because I thought that if we are many with the same belief and possibly with the same exposure, then we can better build our society.
But grooming leaders is not very synonymous with our politics in Uganda. Have you prepared someone that you want to take over you? Or
actually, it's not that I've groomed someone that I want to take over from me, but there are so many girls in Kasese who have been groomed to be ready to take on any challenge.
So what should be your next move? Because you're saying you're out of elective politics, but you're still in the struggle.
I will continue with the struggle for change. I still want to see a Uganda that I have dreamt of many years back, where there is respect for rule of law, where there is democracy, where there is good governance, where there is justice. I will still continue advocating for all this. I will continue advocating for human rights. I will continue advocating for justice for all. So I am actually only not seeking re-election in the Kasese politics, but I will still remain an active politician in the politics of this country.
You're saying you're going to remain an active politician. Is it by coincidence that the constitution of the Alliance for National Transformation talks of a national chairperson who does not hold an elective position?
Actually,
and on the other hand, you have Geno Muntu giving way for the position of national coordinator to become flag bearer. Is it by coincidence?
Well, I think I will say by coincidence, possibly, because for me, this decision, I took it many years ago before I even knew there was going to be an alliance, Alliance for National Transformation. And I had never even dreamt of that party, had never known its constitution would be like that. Because for me, when I was seeking this term, I actually shared it with a few elders that I'm going for this term and it's going to be my last term. When I told them I was not going to seek re-election, they said, hey, you mean you can respect what you say? It comes back to what you said. That some politicians say we are not seeking re-election, but they come back and say, here we come again. So for me, it is a decision I took at the beginning of this term. And along the way, the alliance is born with the constitution, the way you are saying it. The two are really not in any way related, but they seem to be working together.
Probably let's get this out of the way since we've started talking about the Alliance for National Transformation. There is a wave that is sweeping in the FDC. Your political party members are quitting. Others are saying they're not going to stand on the party ticket. Others are joining ANT. Others are joining other political parties. Where do you stand?
As we speak, I am a member of the FDC.
You are a member of the FDC,
yes.
Who works very closely,
supporting Jenny Muntu. I actually work with all forces of change.
Interestingly, when the Alliance for National Transformation was launched,
yes,
you were seated in a very strategic position in a purple dress.
I may not really say I relate my purple to the Alliance. Can you be informed that on my wedding day, my changing dress was purple? And that was far back in 2009.
Probably.
And then the Alliance was not even thought of. The maids were adorned in blue. My changing dress was a purple. And I can tell you I love purple. So possibly I can love the Alliance for the purple color because I love it.
And I'll tell you, you must have been one of the people that the founders of the ANT consulted in forming the party and all. So
I might not have been consulted about the colors. I can tell you that I was not consulted about the colors. But by coincidence, I found some colors that I love are in the colors of the Alliance.
And today you in red, so sometimes you're hobnobbing with the people.
Not
power,
hobnobbing,
the other times,
if you may know, by the way, know this from me today, that this red movement started in parliament during the Toji Kwatako, and
in
I was the
office.
Champion of the Toji Kwatako campaign. So it is a thing that I believe in. I believe in Uganda, I believe in the African and in humanity, having the same blood, no matter how we look like. So for me, red is a color that I hold so dear to me because it represents brotherhood and sisterhood to me. So it's not really that it's the color for the people power, though predominantly the people power has taken it up. You may also wish to know that red was in the colors of UPC. Red is in the national flag. Red is in the colors of the Alliance. Red is also in the colors of the FDC.
So you're still FDC?
Have I told you otherwise?
You should tell your viewer out.
The viewer out there knows that I'm FDC.
Yes, you're FDC, but you seem to have taken a very back and laid, you took a very laid back position when you left the front bench as leader of opposition. Were you sour grapping because you had lost the position?
I don't think I have ever sour grapped in my life. I've never. And for taking a back bench after the change of office, I was supposed to be a backbench MP, so you wanted me to go and occupy the lead of opposition's seat when I left it?
Before you joined the front bench, you were very active backbench.
Actually, even now I am very active, if you may want to know. Before I became the lead of opposition, you should know that I was a deputy opposition chief whip. I became a chief whip. I became a chairperson of the Committee on Government Assurances. I became a chairperson of the Committee on Local Government Accounts. So all these responsibilities gave me reason to be very active and very available for service. But currently, you may not see much of me because I'm doing much of the work at committee level. That's where you'll see my visibility. In Parliament, either we are coming to table a committee in which my input is present, so you may not see much of me there. You'll only come there to either support or maybe give the guidance on the house, in the house. But Previously, it was almost me on the forefront as chair of a committee, as opposition chief whip, as leader of the opposition. So those roles are different.
Your party president says you, members of parliament that supported the Honorable General Mugisha Muntu in the bid for the FDC presidency in 2017, withdrew their support from the FDC, withdrew from active participation in FDC activities when you were defeated.
Well, I will say it depends on how people were treated. I can tell you that majority of the people who supported General Muntu, it was a contest from outside. It didn't look like a contest from inside. And the other issue was the manifestos of the two and possibly the direction of the campaign. The campaign that won was the campaign for defiance. And we are truly told that one strategy, one party, one strategy. The strategy was defiance. So those of us who believed in different approaches got lost.
Honorable, do you think the country is going to progress politically if in every organization there is a disagreement, you people move on and form another political party?
I doubt whether it is like that, but you also have to stay where you feel you add sense. You don't have to tell me I'm not wanted in your area and you want me to hold on. Now for what? When someone is told, unless you believe in this kind of strategy, then you are not part of us, where do you expect me to go?
You still believe in General Mugisha Muntu's strategy. Are you saying you're not wanted in the FDC?
No, you know, you started with asking us, why did you people withdraw? We withdrew because we believed in a multi-sectoral approach of doing things. We knew that we could use defiance at some point, and then we use strategy at another point. If it meant remaining silent, you could remain silent, but your silence should send a signal. Like many times we do walk out of parliament. Walking out of parliament speaks for us. Sometimes we may decide to keep quiet. There is a time we decided to come in red ribbons. For us, it was making some statement. So when you say all the time you must come in red ribbons, even when they are not necessary, then I'll take a back seat because I know, I think that is not the correct way of sending my message. So somehow we wanted to watch how we are going to reclaim our victory with defiance. Unfortunately, we are not yet there. So it's really not about you coming and asserting yourself on an approach that you don't. Me, somehow, I do things that I believe in solely. When I know that here defiance is going to work, I will apply defiance. When I know that here negotiation is going to work, I will negotiate. When I know that here, I think we need to talk. Whether it will mean flexing, I will flex. So when it is one approach through and through, then I say, let me first watch and see where it is taking us. When time comes for me to put my input, I can always give it.
Where do you think it's taking the party right now with the current developments?
I am not the leader, so you go and ask the leader.
Because some of your colleagues, the ones with whom you believe in a malt approach, have decided to quit.
You know, we are different.
Are you stronger now as FDC?
We are different human beings, and each one of us respond to situations differently. And I can tell you that, of course, we may not say we are stronger than ever before, because you can't call yourself stronger when members are leaving. You would be a little bit lost. Any political party needs members, and that is the preoccupation of political parties. You need numbers, and when numbers are disappearing, you can't say you are getting stronger. Yes, they could be maybe feeling good that those who are not towing the party line are leaving, but it's also not good to just watch as members go. However, if you have been following the Secretary General of the party, has been clear that this is not a prison. Free entry and free exit. So when you come to the aspect of free entry and free exit, members will go as and when they want, and others will join as and when they want. Because when they came in anyway, nobody forced them. They decided on their own and came. When they choose to leave, well, you can tell them, please, let's talk about these things. If you don't reach a compromise, they will still be free to leave. So political parties, I don't think, are prisons where people will be held at ransom and they will only be, they will even be forced to stay without their interest. No.
So, Honorable, if you're not stronger, like you've said, as the FDC at this moment, doesn't that bring to life President Yoweri Museveni's promise that we shall not have an opposition come 2021?
I still believe that wherever the members, what I'm happy about is that even when people are leaving FDC, they are not joining NRM. They are leaving FDC and joining other opposition political parties. To me, that is no big mistake. They are still struggling, only struggling from different sides. And they have been giving people the analogy of someone hunting a rat. One can say, let's use a trap. Another one will say, let's beat it with sticks. Another one says, let's use rat, the rat poison. But all of you are working towards killing this rat. So I wouldn't want someone to say, no. For me, the approach of beating the rat is the only one. The approach of using a trap is the only one. Or the approach of using the rat poison is the only one. As long as both of you or all of you are geared towards the same cause, there would be need to support each other. So for me, I only get so much worried if someone moves from an opposition political party and joins the ruling government. But when someone is moving from FDC and is joining the Alliance for National Transformation or is joining now the National Unity Platform, I just know that all of us are still chasing the same goal.
But Honorable, there are those from the FDC that have joined the NRM.
At least they will always be there. And that's what I've told you, that for me I get worried when I see people leaving the FDC and joining the NRM. But you should also be aware that there are also people leaving the NRM, joining the FDC and other opposition political parties. There are also those who had never participated in any political party activities and are joining parties on the opposition. So what we should be preoccupied with now is how many people are leaving the FDC or the Alliance and are possibly joining Museveni. But for someone to leave FDC and join DP, it doesn't make you useless. No, you are still in the struggle. The only problem here is that people have looked at political parties, some political parties, as if they are the only opposition. To the extent that when you leave it and join another opposition political party, then you cease to matter. No.
So, Honorable, in your view, what should be the way forward for the FDC?
We continue struggling.
But you're losing members.
But of course they are recruiting others. They are recruiting others. So they are losing here and maybe gaining there. Just like, you know, FDC, when it started, it didn't also start from Mars. It started with people from other political parties. I can tell you Dr. Besigye was from the movement, though it was all impressive, but they are the people who started the movement, man. When Museveni started his NRM, he had moved from about DP, he even went to UPC, then went to UPM, and he came to the National Resistance Movement. So me, what I look at most is the heart for some people to continue struggling, is for people to continue with the struggle, no matter where they are struggling from. Me, the person I consider most is the person who is still firm on the struggle, whether in DP or UPC or the Alliance for National Transformation or FDC.
Honorable, there is a feeling that you actually feared being embarrassed with with a defeat in Kasese, the people that you had defeated in 2016 were reorganizing themselves and they were ready to take you on. That is why you took off.
I am telling you that this is a decision I made as soon as I made it in parliament. And I said, I am only going to serve, actually before I even was elected. The elders I'm talking about, I talked to them when I was canvassing for votes. I said, support me this time, I'm not going back. So how could I have feared even before I entered? So for me, I was serving this term knowing that I'm not going to seek re-election. And if I was fearing defeat, by the way, the Kasese people wouldn't be shedding tears the way they were shedding tears when I said bye to them. I'm not just being proud, and that was not a makeup. They genuinely would have voted for me. So for someone to just wake up and say, Winnie was fearing a defeat, how many people have gotten defeated?
Honorable, about a year ago or so, a picture made rounds on social media of you with President Museveni, the Honorable Anita Mong, and the other MPs from Kasese. There is a feeling that probably your giving way in Kasese is preparing you for a juice position.
By the way, you know, people should actually use pictures appropriately. You should know that picture is for almost 4 years ago, when our people were killed in Kasese. And when we were looking for ways of helping our people to come out of prison, this was, I think, this picture was taken in 2016 in December. So when someone says the picture that was taken in 2016 December is used now to say Win, I think, is preparing herself for a ministerial position, I would just call you.
Honorable, I'll tell you why. Your critics say since the Kasese incident, you've been a bit laid back in terms of criticizing the government and in terms of fighting for change.
During that time, I was lead of opposition. You know.
Yes.
So how did I lay back when I was the lead of opposition? You know, people just look at a short thing like they have a very, many people have a short memory, or they just want to use situations selectively. From day one, when I was elected member of parliament, you know that even by the time I was declared MP and with my colleagues with whom we came to parliament, we had to lose life. People had to die. We spoke about that from day one. When our people were killed, we spoke about this from day one and even took President Museveni to the ICC. How did they want me to react? I have led the opposition in parliament as lead of opposition. You saw how I did it. How else would they have wanted me to do it anyway? I want to know so that I can do it better.
Talking about your fight for against the amendment of the age limit, the other accusation that your opponents bring up is that the walkout at a very critical moment, there is a feeling that you should have stayed in parliament and fought. But you led a walkout and people feel the walkout was giving the NRM legroom to do the walkout, I think, on the third day of considering the constitutional amendment.
Did we come back and were even beaten? You didn't see that? That's why I'm telling you that people are really thinking in a short-sighted way. We came back. There is a time when we saw really things were not going the way we thought the parliament should have been handled. We walked out. And I have told you, for us, we do our politics in so many ways. We do believe that at this time, if we walk out, we will make a statement. We walked out to go and reorganize. And we reorganized and came back. We engaged until government saw no way through than bringing the army to beat us in parliament. People were mimed. You can see it from the Honorable Zake, the Honorable Namboze, the Honorable Nabila was beaten, the Honorable Segangeline were beaten. So when people say she was laid back, when people were being bruised on the front line, when we were being tear gassed in Kasubi, Nimbale, and we even continued engaging by going to court. So how?
What you call a walkout to reorganize for the others,
because it was strategic. Because they didn't know. Mm. To us, it was a strategy. We are going to reorganize. Actually, our forces were getting scattered. So I said, guys, let's first withdraw a little. We reorganize, re-engage, and we come back. And we came back until the last minute when the vote was done.
Honorable, you said your meeting with the president was to discuss the issues, what was unfolding in Kasese then. You leave active politics, you leave leadership in Kasese with an unanswered question of the Obusinga.
Yes.
So what next? I mean, the problems of Obusinga are still there. He's still not a free man. The Mumbere is still not a free man. And you're walking away.
That is why I'm telling you that I'm not leaving politics. I'm only not seeking re-election in Kasese. It will not stop me from continuously engaging whoever is ready to listen to us, that there is an injustice, and that's why I told you that I will continue to struggle for justice and ensure that our people get justice. At least the Mumbere was given that pseudo relief from prison and imprisoned at least in his home. And that was part of what we had gone to talk about. I am only not happy that many of the issues that we talked about, and this was not about Winnie, it was about us, the people of Kasese. I was only lucky that I was the leader at that time. And I can tell you, any of the leaders in Kasese can take up the mantle. We can continue working together just like we were working with others who are not in parliament. This was not about us, the parliamentarians. It was about the people of Kasese, and it's still about the people of Kasese. It's about our kingdom that we believe in so much. So even when I'm outside parliament, it doesn't mean I will stop talking about the ills of government. I will not talk about the injustice that is in government. That's why I'm saying leaving, just saying let me take sabbatical leave does not necessarily mean that I'm taking leave from politics. No. I will continue engaging. I will continue speaking for the truth. I will speak about the injustices meted upon our people. I will speak for democracy. I will speak for good governance. And all these issues will be done. And I know that the problems, as long as you think that you are the alpha and omega for every problem, then you end up being a problem. That's why Museveni is stuck here. He thinks he's the only man with a solution to the problems of Uganda. And eventually he ends up creating many more problems. So if I continue positioning myself as the alpha and omega in the issues of Kasese, that unless I'm there, then there is no other person who can maybe resolve and solve the issues of Kasese, I'll end up becoming a problem.
Hasn't the struggle for justice for the people of Kasese been diffused by General Salim Saleh, because he has for the last 4 years camped in Kasese, and they are saying he's dismantling everything that you've put in?
By the way, people have taken the Salim Saleh issue as a very serious issue. I even saw you people in the New Vision saying Salim Saleh has taken projects in Kasese, Salim Saleh is now sorting everybody in Kasese.
That he's meeting people, including you.
I can tell you, I have never met Salim Saleh. Go and ask him. He was in Kasese for 4 months. But I didn't meet him even a single day. Because I had people saying, you know, Winnie is getting out of politics because of the talks they had with Salim Saleh. I have never met Saleh. That is what people should know. And by the way, when they start saying there are projects that government has done and now these projects are the ones that are making Winnie think twice, maybe there is someone who lives in a different Kasese than the one I'm living in.
So what's the situation in Kasese?
The situation is bad. You can't say life is okay when people are in jail for 3 years, 3.5 years, unheard. When their children are dying of hunger. When wives are without husbands. And then someone comes up to say, now we have sorted Kasese. Well, I don't know what kind of sorting it is. I think maybe killing is the sorting.
Honorable, let's take a break.